أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين حمدا بجميع المحامد على جميع النعم حمدا لا يتناهى ملء السماوات السبع وملء الأرض السبع وملء ما بينهما وملء ما شاء الله من شيء بعد وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وكشف الله به الغمة وجاهد في سبيل الله حق جهاده حتى أتاه اليقين فاللهم صل على محمد في الأولين وصل على محمد في الآخرين وصل على محمد في كل وقت وحين وصل على محمد في الملأ الأعلى إلى يوم الدين. جزاكم الله خير for coming. We ask Allah bless you and ask Allah make it easy for me and you. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to admit us to Jannah. Say Ameen. And we ask Allah to save us from an-nar. Say Ameen. We stopped the last time with one of the major sin, which it is Ar-Riya in Arabic, the show off. When you do anything not sincerely to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not 100% sincerely to Allah, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never accept any good deeds from you except if it is itself sincerely to Him only. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put in the Quran al-Kareem and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explain in Sunnah three conditions for your good deeds to be accepted. Three conditions, very, very important, every Muslim must know it. If you miss any one of it, you lost your good deeds. First one, believe in Allah. No shirk, no kufr. If you do good deeds while you have a shirk, you have nothing. If you do good deeds while you are doing kufr, does not believe in Allah, you have nothing. Second condition is sincerely to Allah, no show off. I explained the last halaqah with all details about the show off and what it is, and from Quran and from Sunnah, go back to it, is a very, very important. Show off with any deeds will destroy your good deeds completely. If you do it for Allah and also for the people and for your own ego and for the dunya, you have nothing. Because there is hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I already explained the last time, the summary. مَنْ عَمِلَ مِنْهُمْ عَمَلَ الْآخِرَةِ لِلدُّنْيَا لَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ فِي الْآخِرَةِ نَصِيبُ. Whoever doing the good deeds should be for hereafter, for the sake of Allah. He do it for the sake of dunya, he will never have any reward in the Akhirah. For that, number one, believe in Allah, no shirk, no kuf. Number two of the condition, sincerely to Allah Azza wa Jal, no any kind of show off. Number three, must be according to the Quran and Sunnah. If it's not according to the Quran and Sunnah, bid'ah. Even sincerely, and even believe in Allah, and bid'ah, Allah will never accept bid'ah. Any kind of bid'ah, bid'ah innovation. Bid'ah is something not according to Quran, not according to Sunnah, something new, something they add. A lot of people say to them, it's not Sunnah. Oh, it's okay. What's the problem? It's just so-and-so. And they give reasons and excuses. You will never be going to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with committed, going near and close to Allah who is committing sin. And bid'ah is a sin. For that you will never be near to Allah by committing bid'ah. And the hadith is very clear about that. When some people saw, one of them said, I will fast, even fasting in Islam. But he will do it with a way not according to Rasulullah. Fast day and night. The other one said, I will not marry. The third one, he said, I will pray the whole night. Rasulullah said, this is not my way. This is not my sunnah. And there is also another halaqah, alhamdulillah, explained about following the Quran and the sunnah and know any kind of bid'ah. Explained very well, alhamdulillah. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the most thing I fear about my ummah is show off. Because when you do it, and already explained with the hadith of Rasulullah, the three people, the one who was martyred, and the second one was Allah give him all kind of different kind of money, and the third one who learned the Quran, and they did not do it for the sake of Allah. They come in front of Allah and they say, oh, we did it for your sake. Allah said, you're lying. You are a liar. You did it. You did being going in the fighting in order for the people to say about you, you are courage and you are a strong man and good one. And he already they say, go for those people and take your reward from them. For the one who's been asked about his money, he said, yeah, Allah spend it for your sake. Allah said, you're lying, because Allah knows your intention. Make sure when you do anything, do it sincerely for the sake of Allah only. He did it in order for the people to say about him, did the sadaqat and the donation, that he's generous and he's a good man. Oh, this man, excellent. You already did it for the people? Go and take the reward from the people. This is what Allah will say to you in the Akhirah. Suppose I did it and I didn't know, correct your intention and never have it again. The third one who reads the Quran or who learns the knowledge, same also, for the sake of the people, for the sake of the dunya, for the sake of the position, not for Allah Azza wa Jal. And this is of life or everything. I don't want to take long time with it. Today, go back to the halaqa of show off, you will see more. And it is very important. Today, Kabira number 38. And it is about ta'allum ay al-ilm al-dini aw al-ilm ammatan lid-dunya wa kitman al-ilm. Learning the knowledge of the religion for the sake of the worldly life, for the sake of getting money, for the sake of getting position, for that means the intention is not for Allah. Because when you learn the knowledge, must learn it for the sake of Allah, not for show off, not to argue with the people with it, not to show your position, I know, but more than this man. No, learn it for the sake of Allah, then apply it. And this one of the kaba'ir, one of the major sin, when you learn it for the sake of people, for the sake of your ego, for the sake of your nafs. And also including, also concealing and hiding the knowledge is also one of the calamity, one of the major sin in Islam. Imam Zahabi in his book Al-Kaba'ir, he starts with a big certificate from Allah to every alim. A huge and so good certificate from Allah. Allah himself, a gift certificate in Al-Quran. Surah Fatir, verse number 35, I mean Surah number 35, ayah number 28. What Allah said? إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءِ إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءِ It is only, Allah say, it is only those who have the knowledge among my slaves is on who fear me. Certificate from Allah that the real true mu'min is the alim who fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Only those who have the knowledge, only those who have the knowledge, is the one who, among my slaves, among the creation, is the one who fear Allah. The one who have the knowledge is the one who fear Allah. Only the learned men among the slaves of Allah is the one who fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah have a certificate with them. And he said here, يعني العلماء بالله, the people who knows Allah, who knows the power of Allah, who knows the greatness of Allah, who knows that Allah is omnipotent, who knows the glory of Allah, who knows the dominion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, who is alim? Because sometimes we'll get different. Oh, this is alim, this is not alim. I will go to the one who is learned, go to the one who is deep in knowledge. Subhanallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not leave anything. Rasulullah also explained. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, من حافظ ومن علم الست سور الأول فهو عالم من القرآن. ست سور الأول من القرآن فهو عالم. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whoever know the first six surah of the Quran, which it is like Al-Fatiha and Al-Baqarah and Al-Imran, mentioned in hadith itself, this surah, and it is in a silsala sahiha, Rasulullah testified to him that he is a alim. Whoever memorizes it and knows the meaning of it. That Rasulullah is a certificate from Rasulullah. And Allah say, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءِ Only those who have the knowledge, who is alim among his slaves, is the one who fear Allah Azza wa Jal. Ibn Abbas said, قَالَ يُرِيدُ إِنَّمَا يَخَافُنِي مِنْ خَلْقِي مَنْ عَلِمَ جَبَرُوتِي وَعِزَّتِي وَسُلْطَانِي The one who really fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from his creation is the one who knows Allah, is the one who knows the power of Allah, is the one who knows the mercy of Allah. When you know Allah, you will fear him. When you know Allah, you will love him. When you know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will be from the people who is a real alim. Imam Mujahid wa Shu'abi said, Al-alim man khaf Allah. The alim, the real alim, is the one who fear Allah. Imam Rabi' ibn Anas, قال من لم يخش الله فليس بعالم. Whoever does not fear Allah is not عالم. Then the second part of the same kabira, that hiding the knowledge, and those who hide the knowledge do not show off with it, but do not hide it. You have to balance yourself. Do not show off with it, but also if you have the knowledge, forbidden for you to hide the knowledge. If you hide it while you know, for it doesn't matter what the reason, أُولَٰئِكَ يَلْعَنُهُمُ اللَّهُ وَيَلْعَنُهُمُ اللَّاعِنُونَ. لَعْنَةُ of Allah will be upon them, and لَعْنَةُ of the curse also. Whoever curse, will, some of the curse will come to them. In the Quran, Surah Al-Baqarah, verse number 159, Allah Azza wa Jalla said, إن الذين يكتمون ما أنزلنا من البينات والهدى من بعد ما بيناه للناس في الكتاب أولئك يلعنهم الله ويلعنهم اللاعنون. Truly those who conceal the clear evidences, truly those who hide the knowledge. Sometimes the shaitan come whispering to us also. If I say, talking about, suppose the salah as example only, and in Jum'ah or in Khutbah, or the people who does not pray will get angry. If I talk about the salah, don't talk about the zakah, or the people who does not pay zakah. If I talk about the boyfriend and girlfriend, the people who have boyfriend and girlfriend, do not hide the knowledge. Talk. Whoever get mad, get mad. Deal with Allah Azza wa Jal. If you try to please the people and make Allah angry, Allah will be angry. And Allah will make the people angry. You will never be pleased them. For that, be sincerely to Allah. Say the truth as long as from the Quran and Sunnah. Otherwise here, all those who conceal the knowledge, the clear evidences, the proofs, and the guidance, which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, which we revealed it after we made it clear to the people, clear to the whole mankind, in the book, those are cursed by Allah. This is number one. Cursed by Allah and cursed by those who curse. Those who curse, some of the curse will come to those who hide the knowledge. And this ayah, as he mentioned in Imam al-Dhahabi in his book Al-Kaba'ir, nazalat fi ulama' al-Yahud, in the scholar of the Jewish, and he said, arada al-bayinat, the clear evidences, like bayinat of what? Al-rajm, wal-hudud, wal-ahkam, the commandment, the prescribed punishment, and the rules, regulations, and also the meaning of al-huda, which is the guidance. Here in this ayah, some of the explanations say about al-huda means Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because it was in the Torah and in the Injil, and they hide it. That there is a messenger coming, which is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or Ahmad, they hide it. For that, cursed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. من بعد ما بيناه للناس للناس here for the people the بني إسرائيل في الكتاب in the Torah and also in the إنجيل أولئك those who hide those knowledge will be cursed by Allah and cursed by the cursor. Ibn Abbas said they will be cursed by بكل شيء إلا الجن والإنس. Everything will curse them except the human being and the jinn. Ibn Mas'ud قال ما تلاعن اثنان من المسلمين إلا رجعت تلك اللعنة على الذين يكتمون أمر محمد وصفته. He said if two people of the Muslim cursing each other or any curse anywhere, some of this curse will go back because of this ayah. That the curser will be getting some, if anyone curse any other one, some of the curse will go to those who hide the matter of Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. And they say no, there is no any messenger after. Allah Azza wa Jal also taken a covenant, a pledge with the alims, that make it clear to the people and never hide it, and also do not put it behind you. What does it mean? It's not physically to put it behind you. Do not put it behind means do not neglect it. Do not act upon it. No, you have to act upon it. You have to make it clear to the people. Allah give me the knowledge, you should give it to the people. Should explain. Don't fear except Allah Azza wa Jalla. I already have this experience with a lot of people explaining something. They sometimes misunderstand it. Sometimes by Allah, I don't know that it is related to them. They think, oh, we're talking against us. I am not. Ayat of Allah, I cannot hide it. As I told you, suppose Do not talk about salah in order for the people who does not pray will get angry. No, leave it now. Do not talk about zakah because a lot of people don't pay zakah. Then they will be angry. Oh, leave it now. Subhanallah, then you will leave the whole Islam. Any ayat, any ahadith, as long as the hadith is authentic, say it clearly and directly. And for yourself, accept it because it is from Allah to you. Yes, through me, I'm only just giving the message. But it is Quran of Allah and Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah takes a covenant with the learned people that never hide it and make it clear. Where is the ayah? Ala Imran, surah number 3, verse number 187. What Allah said? وَإِذْ أَخَذَ اللَّهُ مِيثَاقَ الَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْكِتَابَ لَتُبَيِّنُنَّهُ لِلنَّاسِ وَلَا تَكْتُمُونَهُ فَنَبَذُوهُ وَرَاءَ ظُهُورِهِمْ وَاشْتَرَوْا بِهِ ثَمَنًا قَلِيلًا فَبِئْسَ مَا يَشْتَرُونَ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took a covenant, a pledge. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the alims from those who had received the scriptures, received the knowledge, to make it known, to make it clear to the people and never ever hide it. Make it clear and do not hide it. Do not conceal it. Don't fear except Allah. I'm saying the shaitan knows this ayah. It will come to your mind and say, oh, but also at the opposite of that, never give fatwa while you don't know. As I told in the khutbah yesterday, that a lot of mufti we have these days. Everybody is a mufti. He knows, he doesn't know. Just whatever is in his mind, he will say it. Should not. نصف العلم لا أدري. Half of the knowledge when you say, I don't know. The greatest of the ulama, like Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, Imam Malik, and a lot of them. A lot of time, when they come to ask them about some of the things, they say, we don't know it. One man, I remember, he traveled 3 months and he went to one of the biggest ulama. I think, Wallahu A'lam, if I'm not mistaken, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, or maybe Imam Malik, one of the biggest ulama. Then he said to him, I'm coming 3 months and this is my question. He said, I don't know it. That man, he get mad. I'm traveling 3 months for you and you are the very well-known person now and have a lot of knowledge and you say, I don't know. He said, by Allah, if you are traveling all of your life, I don't know, I don't know. And those people was very truthful. For that here, you are ordered not to hide it if you have it. But if you do not have it, you are ordered also from the other side, do not give what you don't have. Do not give a fatwa while you don't know. And ulama of the Sahaba, the ulama of Sahaba, they used to run away from the fatwa. Really? It used to be question coming to one of them, he will say, this Sahabi is have more knowledge than me. You can go to him. He will go to him and say, that alim, that Sahabi have more knowledge, you can ask him. Until it goes back, circle, until it goes back to the first one he was asking. They are not running for making themselves in a position or giving a fatwa. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, make it clear to the people and never hide it. But what they did, they throw it, the covenant, and they throw the knowledge behind their backs. And bought with it, they purchased with it, miserable gain, which it is a worldly life, money. Then evil and the worst is that which they have brought. Imam al-Wahidi, he said, this is ayah, come down for the ulama of Yahud, because Allah takes a covenant from them in the Torah to make the matter of Sayyidina Muhammad clear to the people after that, and his objective and his qualities and who is he, but and do not hide it about Sayyidina Muhammad, but they did, they hide it. For that Allah say, تُبَيِّنُنَّهُ لِلنَّاسِ وَلَا تَكْتُمُونَهُ. Make it clear to the people and make it. But this is, does not apply only to the Jewish, does apply to anyone who has the knowledge and he hide it. Any kind of knowledge, it is a general. For that, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, matter of Rasulullah, when it is be hidden, even they know about it in their own book, this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, part of the meaning of the ayah. They put it behind their back, Ibn Abbas, he said, they put this covenant behind themselves and they did not listen to it. And they purchased with it the position. This is, this will be applied to the Muslims also. When you try to learn the knowledge for a position, you try to show the people that I have a knowledge in order for the people to give you more respect. No, deal with Allah and Allah will make the people to respect you. Be sincerely to Allah in anything you are doing. فَبِئْسَ مَا يَشْتَرُونَ قَالَ ابْنُ عَبَّاسِ قَابُوا حَشُرَاؤُهُمْ وَخَسِرُونَ. Evil what they buy with, or whatever they bought, or whatever they gain of a position or money or whatever it is, and they are the most loser one. For that learning the knowledge, any knowledge, but specifically the knowledge of the religion, for the sake of dunya, for the sake of the money, for the sake of the position, for the sake of power, politics, listen to what Rasulullah narrated by Ibn Majah, Ibn Hibban, and Abu Dawood, Wal-Hakim, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, من تعلم علما مما يبتغى به وجه الله لا يتعلمه إلا ليصيب به عارضا من الدنيا لم يجد عرف الجنة. Listen to the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Whoever learn the knowledge, which this knowledge should be seeking with it or through it the pleasure of Allah Azza wa Jal, should be for Allah, should be sincerely for Allah. But he learned in order to get some of the worldly life, money or position or it can apply for a lot of things. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, if he get the knowledge which should be sincerely for Allah, knowledge of religion, knowledge of the worldly life, should be for Allah Azza wa Jal, but he get it for the sake of the dunya, then he will never find the smell of the Jannah, never enter it. The text saying will never find the smell of the Jannah. In hadith of Abu Huraira, narrated by Imam Muslim, we take it the last time, when the three people, the martyr, and the one who was the owner of the money, and the one who is the one who learned the knowledge in order for the people to say about him that he is big alim. But it depends upon his intention. It's not for you to judge the people. To say that man he learned in order for so and so, show off, no. Allah knows his intention, it's between him and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not for everyone to judge the other one and make fighting about it. No. This is something between the one who is learning and Allah Azza wa Jalla, and Allah knows it. It's not for me or you to judge in one thing, how this one learning for so and so. No. For that here, the first one who was martyred, it was for the sake of dunya. Allah say, he said to Allah, I did it for you. Allah said, you are lying. You did it in order for the people to say about you, you are a courage. And you are a strong man and you are a good one. And you already say, in another hadith, say, go and take your reward from them. For the one who has the money, Allah asked him, I give you the money. Yes, he said, yes. What did you do with it? In Muslim, but this is a summary. He said, oh Allah, I did it for your sake and I spend it for your sake. He said, no, you spend it in order for the people. Now the intention here, for the people to say about you are a generous man. Go for the people and take the reward from them. The third one, the one who learns the knowledge in order for the people to say about him that he is a alim, Allah will say to him, already they say, khalas, this is your reward. You are doing it in order for them to say, right? Your reward will be that they already said. No any other reward. But when you do it for Allah Azza wa Jal, Allah will make the people to know that you are alim, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you more than what you deserve. In Tirmidhi, hadith very important. The summary of it, never learn the knowledge in order to compete with the people, in order to make yourself higher. Never learn the knowledge, never ever learn the knowledge in order to dispute and to argue with the people. Never learn the knowledge in order to also attract the mind and the heart for the people for yourself. Some people, they do that. When you learn the knowledge, learn it sincerely for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal only. Listen to the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasulullah said, من ابتغى العلم أن الترمذي ليباهي به العلماء the number one أو ليماري به السفهاء أو number three أو تقبل أفئدة الناس إليه بسبب العلم الذي عنده فإلى النار والعياذ بالله. That means this knowledge does not benefit him in anything. رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم say, if anyone seeks the knowledge to use it in the competition between the people, to make himself higher, that all the others is jahil. For that, he learned it not for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal, for the sake of his own ego. Or he learned it, Rasulullah say, to dispute with the foolish people, to dispute with the others. Or He learned it to attract the mind or to attract the heart and the attention, to attract the attention of the other people. Oh, this man have a lot. No. You should do it for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jalla, and let the people do whatever and say whatever they say. Even they say it, but your intention sincerely for Allah, you are saved. But if your intention for them to say, when you learn or when you do any good deed, doesn't matter what it is, small or big, then you lost it. For that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will cause him to enter hell. That means the knowledge he did for disputing with the people or for showing off or for attracting the mind or the attention of the people does not benefit him in anything, because at the end he went to hellfire. Also, always seek refuge with Allah from a knowledge that will not benefit you. When you show off with it, this is not beneficial knowledge, right? Or that seek refuge, and this is dua of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi. Also ask Allah to save you from getting a knowledge and you don't do according to it. Seek refuge with Allah and ask Allah to save you from also giving a knowledge and doing the opposite of it. Say to the people, this is haram. And in between you and yourself, you do it. Don't do that. Then he do it. A'udhu billah. Listen to hadith of Rasulullah narrated by Imam Muslim, wa Tirmizi, wa Nasa'i. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, A'udhu bika min ilmin. Part of the hadith. A'udhu bika min ilmin la yanfa'. Oh Allah, I seek refuge with you from a knowledge will not benefit me. From any knowledge will not benefit me. Part of the meaning of the hadith, from the knowledge when you show off with it. From the knowledge when you do it in order to make yourself a big alim in between the people. For that here, Allah, we ask Allah save us from, also it could be, there is some of the knowledge other than the religion, out of the religion, scientific. It's a harmful knowledge. We ask Allah save us from that. It's not beneficial. Do you get my point? Also in another hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, narrated by Imam al-Tirmizi, من تعلم علما لم يعمل به لم يزده العلم إلا كبره. Whoever learn a knowledge and he does not do according to it, it will increase his arrogance. There is other hadith, Rasulullah say, whoever have a weight of an atom, nothing, very, very little, of arrogance, kibr in Arabic, arrogance in his heart will never enter al-Jannah. What is arrogance? Rasulullah define it. Bataru al-haqq wa ghamtu al-nas. Refusing the truth. Refusing the truth is arrogance. And looking down to the people. You feel that you are higher than them. I am very smart. Everybody stupid. I am very high. Everybody down. A'udhu billah. I will ask Allah save us from being like that. Say ameen. In another hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, narrated by Imam Muslim, والإمام البيهقي وابن حبان for الإمام مسلم narrated by أسامة ابن زيد for الإمام البيهقي وابن حبان narrated عن أنس رضي الله عنه. He wrote it down by mistake or by printing mistake, wrote it by أبو أمامة. It is أنس or أسامة for الإمام مسلم and أسامة ابن زيد for الإمام ابن حبان والبيهقي by أنس ابن مالك. But by mistake written أبو أمامة that رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم said, يجاء بالعالم السوء يوم القيامة فيقذف في النار فيدور بقصبه كما يدور الحمار بالرحى فيقال له بما لقيت هذا وإنما اهتدينا بك فيقول كنت أخالفكم لما إلى ما أنهاكم عنه. Never say to the people to do the right and you do the wrong. Never say to the people to do the good and you do the bad. Never order the people to do the right and you do the wrong. When you do that, listen to hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's whoever of the ulama or claiming that is alim, because if he's a real alim, he will not do. Doing that, Rasulullah said, alim is su, the evil alim, bad alim. Who is the bad alim? He will be brought to hellfire, and his stomach and his, one of the meaning of the hadith, will be like filling down. And he will be going, as Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, do you know the donkey when they put him in the grindstone and going around the grindstone? Do you know the grind, the big one all the time when they do is sometimes the olive oil, the olives, and sometimes for the grains, and they put the donkey in order to make it. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam say that evil alim, when he do that, when he say to the people to do and he do the opposite, then he will be like the donkey in hellfire. And his stomach will be coming out, stepping on it and doing, look how azab he have. In another hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, as Rasulullah mentioned in the meaning of it, there is no any doubt the ahadith and the ayat ordering us. I'm not saying do not learn. I'm not saying neglect the knowledge. This will be wrong also. Because the first ayah revealed to us in the Quran, Iqra, read, learn. But learn for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not for the sake of dunya, not for the sake of your ego, not for the sake of raising yourself, not for the sake of position, not for the sake of the power, only for the sake of Allah. And this is need a struggle from you all the time. Show off, as Rasulullah say, show off with the knowledge, with the memorizing of Quran, with whatever, will come to you like a small black ant walking in a very smooth rock in a very dark night. Will you see it? You will not. Sometimes it goes to your heart, same exactly. For that, when you do any good deed, do it sincerely for the sake of Allah. When you learn the knowledge, we will stop with Hilal ibn al-Ula. He mentioned Imam al-Dhahabi about him. The summary of it is, there is, in order to get the knowledge, number one, you seek for the knowledge. You go and struggle to go and learn. Like some of you, Jazakumullah khair, coming from a long distance, one of the intentions should be to learn. For that, seeking the knowledge, this is number one. Second thing, to memorize it, to put it in your memory. The third thing, to do according to it. Quran and Sunnah. The fourth thing is to be safe. To be in a safe side. I'll explain. Hilal ibn al-Ula, as he mentioned already, he said, طَالَبُ الْعِلْمِ شَدِيدٌ وَحِفْظُهُ أَشَدُّ مِنْ طَلَبِهِ وَالْعَمَلُ بِهِ أَشَدُّ مِنْ حِفْظِهِ والسلامة منه أشد من العمل به. These are levels. Listen to it. Seeking the knowledge is hard already. You struggle to leave the dunya and come to the deen, to leave your sleeping and come to study and so on. So, for the seeking the knowledge itself, the first step is hard. Harder than it when you try to keep that in your memory. When you try to memorize, need more effort. And it is higher degree, and it is deeper. For that, this is higher and harder, more harder, as he's saying. More harder than seeking it. Applying it in your life and do according to it is harder than also putting it in your memory. And remaining safe from the knowledge you have. How you be remaining safe? Some of it, when you do not hide it, you are safe. Some of it, when you do not show off with it, you are safe. For that, the highest thing is to save yourself in front of Allah with the knowledge you have. Save yourself, do not show off with it. Save yourself, do not hide it. Save yourself, do not use it in a wrong way. Any wrong way, show off is a wrong way. Doing what? Learning the wrong knowledge also. I'm not talking about the religion. I'm talking about the scientific one, a wrong knowledge. Learning the wrong knowledge and doing it wrong, learning it is wrong, and applying it is wrong, then you are not safe. For that, the first step, learn higher and harder when you memorize, higher and harder when you apply, higher and harder and the best in order to get the reward when you save yourself from the show-off, when you save yourself when you hide from hiding it, when you save yourself from the knowledge itself by any mistake way. Here we stop with what Imam Zahabi stop with. InshaAllah, the next Kabira, Kabira number 39, about betraying. And how much betraying nowadays. Do you know that you can betray by your eye and while you don't know? While you don't know. When you look in a thing, not allowed for you to look in it, this is also betraying. Allah mentioned in Quran al-Kareem, inshallah the next time, more details. Surah al-Anfal, surah number 8, ayah number 27. Allah Azza wa Jal said, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لا تخونوا الله والرسول لا تخونوا الله والرسول وتخونوا أماناتكم وتخونوا أماناتكم وأنتم تعلمون. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, O you who believe, do not betray Allah, do not betray Rasulullah, never ever betray Allah, never ever betray Rasulullah when you disobey them, and never knowingly betray your trusts. What is trust? Amana. Amana is the things entrusted to you. This is one of the meaning of the amana. When I give you this and say, this is for you, amana with you, keep it. When you betray it, doesn't matter, any kind of betraying. One of the major sin, a lot of ayat and hadith coming about it. Also part of the amana, the duties which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala order you to do it, and when you do not do it, you are betraying. Or that do not betray Allah and Rasulullah when you disobey. Do not, وَتَخُونُوا أَمَانَتِكُمْ, do not betray the amana, which it is, anything entrust you. Suppose I entrust you the one word, even one word, and I said to you, never say to nobody. Then what the people do? He will go say to everybody. And he will say to everybody, please, never say to nobody. Ya akhi subhanallah, you yourself did betray. Betraying in general forbidden. And especially the trust. Also honesty, being must be honest. Inshallah, more ayat and more ahadith about the Kabir number 39, inshallah. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept from us. And always remember me in your dua, in the best of your dua. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept our own good deeds. And we ask Allah to admit us to Jannah. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save us from the nar. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by His great name to make it easy for us in dunya and akhirah. And to give us light in dunya and light in akhirah and light in our grave. And make us happy in dunya and happy in our grave and happy in akhirah. Allahumma afir lana dhunubana. Allahumma kaffir anna sayyatina. Allahumma tawaffana ma'al abrar. Allahumma shfi marda al-muslimina ajma'ina hayya qayyum. اللهم إنا نسألك الهدى والتقى والعفاف والغنى واغننا بحلالك عن حرامك وبطاعتك عن معصيتك وفضلك عمن سواك. اللهم اهدنا فيمن هديت وتولنا فيمن توليت وقنا واصرف عنا يا مولانا شر ما قضيت. إنك سبحانك تقضي بالحق ولا يقضى عليه وإنه لا يذل من واليت ولا يعز من عاديت. نستغفرك ونتوب إليك. اللهم اجعلنا وأهالينا وبلادنا وبلاد المسلمين وكل مسلم ومسلمة يا ذا الجلال والإكرام في ضمانك وأمانك وإحسانك وحفظك ورعايتك ونصرك وتأييدك. وانصر من نصرنا واخذل من خذلنا. اللهم انصر من نصرنا وانصر الإسلام والمسلمين فوق كل أرض وتحت كل سماء يا رب العالمين. واحفظ بلاد المسلمين واحفظ المسلمين من كل مكروه وسوء. وابسط علينا وعلى بلاد المسلمين بسط الخير والأمن والنور والهدى يا ذا الجلال والإكرام. وارحنا وفرحنا واسترنا ولا تفضحنا. وصلي اللهم على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. وجزاكم الله خيرا. والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله.